a very august assembly and friends, some of whom I have never met before, because if you want to invoke what is being an Indian, I think we will have to remember none other than the Nobel laureate of India, Kavi Rabindranath Tagore, who has said there are no strangers in the world, there are just friends who had never met before. So I see amongst you a few friends I'm meeting for the first time. At the onset, I would like to point out a few funny paradoxes of the situation. The first being that I'm speaking on India, because India is a part of the narration. And one of the most paradoxical and funny things about India that a foreigner has said is, and a Britisher has said mainly, because he's a native speaker of English, has said it, that India is a strange country divided by 1,000 native languages and unified by a single foreign language, that is English. So here lies the paradox. And this is the first level of paradox of the day, or rather the evening, since day has run its course and we are now slowly towards the fag end of the day. The second paradox is that I'm here to address this august assembly in a book, a function related to a book, or rather a series of books. And that is happening in the city of Surat, which is in Gujarat. And we Gujaratis have a typical love and hate relationship with books. Not that we don't love them, we do love them. But when it comes to reading, I think an average Gujarati would love to read a passbook. And when it comes to writing, with some heavy heart, he would write in a checkbook. These are the usual books that we come across. And in spite of that, now there is a paradox. This is one side of the story. The other side of the story is that this is the only land in recorded human history where an emperor of emperors, a king of kings, has walked on his feet with a book placed high on an elephant. And that too written by a priest who had no earthly belongings whatsoever. The first book of Gujarati grammar, Siddhaham Shabdanushasan. So again, there is a paradox in it, and there is a funny paradox of that. And the funniest part is, and most paradoxical part is, that I am going to try and indulge myself into discussing with you, my friends, about the past, present and future of English in India. I recollect a story of a very great but unfortunately not so famous historian, and you will realize why he was not so very famous, that he was a very great teacher of history and wanted to write on world history. So he had completed his entire volume and was waiting for a friend to meet, and so that he may be able to give an opinion, a fellow academician. So in a street in London, when he was waiting for his friend and his friend was to arrive at a particular time, he noticed a bit of a commotion from his window that was happening in the street below, just next to the adjacent part of the window. And he saw some small sort of a quarrel going on, a cabbie and a horse. Though horse was not the participant of the quarrel, it was just a witness. But a horse-driven cab was there and a cabbie was arguing, and he could see a lady arguing passionately and a man standing and some beggar over there and things like that. And he deduced that maybe they are arguing about the fare and they might have agreed upon some different fare. Now the cabbie has grown greedy and is asking for more fare. Then the workmaid who was working in his house, he saw her coming across the street and She came upstairs and he asked her that what was the quarrel about? You have just passed that area, so what was the quarrel about? So she said that a horse had run over a beggar and a lady was quite agitated and she was asking the cabbie to apologize to that beggar. And when he was in discussion with the lady, he saw his friend, a fellow academician and a historian, coming, walking across the street, and the fellow was also a very passionate fellow, so he also participated in the discussions going on around the quarrel. And for a few minutes he was standing there, and then he came upstairs. And therefore, this friend, this writer of the book, asked him as to what the quarrel was all about. And he said that the lady's purse had been taken away by a man, and the cabbie got hold of that man and he was returning the purse to her, and she was confused as to where, as the culprit should be taken to the police station in that cab or not. Listening to all these three stories, he immediately picked up his book and threw it into the fire that was burning for warmth. He said that if I cannot understand what is happening in front of my eyes, in the immediate vicinity of my house, I am going to write about what happened in the past and what dynasties ruled over what places and what was the condition of people in those times. It's all paradoxical. It's of no use. We are destined to be ignorant about some things, and it better be that way. So that's another paradox, that I am going to speak about the past, the present and the future without having any inclination of either of the things. But still, I've been called upon by a friend, and in India it is not customary to refuse a friend. So here I am in front of you trying to tell you something about which I desperately need some understanding and information. But since I am confused, I'll like to share that confusion, and not only share that confusion but even spread that confusion amongst you. It's a contagiousness. It's a very strange phenomenon that when one is confused, he is called upon to spread that confusion to the multitudes. Fortunately, we are not so many that the confusion will be a wildfire. But still, these are the paradoxes amongst which we are here going to discuss about the past, the present and the future of English. And with a sober mindset and with a sober feeling of humbleness, I take upon the task. I do not know if it is a coincidence or what, that we are discussing this topic in Surat, because Surat is the place where the British landed for the first time. Sir Thomas Rowe, when in 1600, some say in 1599, but since 1600 is a round figure, better stick to that because it's not very strenuous on human memory. So in 1600, the East India Company was established. It was neither the first nor the last East India Company to be established, but the only English East India Company to be established. And then ships started arriving in Surat. Now I do not know, but there is a theory. Surat is a region my friend and colleague Arpit Bhai hails from Bhavnagar, where language is very sober. It is basically a taboo to speak certain words. But in Surat, if you want to say that you are an intimate friend with somebody, and if you are asked what type of a relation do you have with him or her, the phrase gaala gaali no is used. So I do not know if the typical way of narration, the Surti way of narration, is a product of the arrival of British here or not. I do not know. The French came over here, the British came over here, the Portuguese came over here, the Dutch came over here, Arabs were already over here at that point in time. Africans were already over here in that point of time. The Russians were already here. The Armenians were already here. And there are graves to prove what I am saying. So I am not saying in vacuum, but there are historical proofs to prove that they were here. And every one of them brought their own set of abuses to Surat. And Surat was the melting pot of all the abuses. And we have been very imaginative, very creative, and very expressive about those things since the arrival of the British and English. Now, I do not know whether the past of English should begin with the Battle of Plassey or should begin with the arrival of the first English ships on the shores of Surat, or should begin with the defeat of the Portuguese in the vicinity of Surat, rather in Surat, in Suwali, because Suwali is now part of Greater Surat, as we call it, where the British Indian Navy was born. The first British fighting force on the continent of Asia was born. Or whether I should begin from Agincourt, where the British decisively defeated the French. Their longbows were too much for the French armor, and they could score a decisive victory over the French. Or should I indulge into the collapse of Russia in coming to the nearer present situation, or the bubble in which the Chinese have enveloped themselves, or the internet saga? I do not know where to start, where to proceed, and where to end. And as I said, I will merely be spreading around the confusion that I am presently in, so that you all may be evenly confused before I conclude. And you may throw a few confusing questions at me and each other, because there are a number of experts present over here who have done more work in English than I. I am basically not per se a person of English language, or rather who has been an academician belonging to that particular genre. But I think that it will be safer to start by saying, and I am starting for the 7th, 8th time, so please bear with me. This is my practice to start a speech number of times. But when I start speaking about the past, I think I should also consider that oversimplification should be avoided. It is very easy to say that English is a colonial heritage. We were ruled for so many years by the British, and therefore English has come over here to stay. Had that been the case, Portuguese or Dutch would also have been there to stay in the parts where they colonized. We go to Daman, for what purpose I would not like to mention in August assembly. I am a teetotaler, so in any case I am not much concerned about why people go to Daman. But Daman is just next to us. How many people do you see in Daman speaking Portuguese? How many people in Div, in Saurashtra, do you speaking Portuguese? Rarely anybody, or rather I have not come across anybody speaking Portuguese. So had it been only a colonial vestigial sort of a thing, English would not have taken roots in India. It is only because it is a lingua franca of the world that we have bothered to retain English. Or else, we would have thrown it away like every other language that has come across. We have not done the same with the French language. Even in, my friend often visits Pondicherry, I have not. But I have heard that French survives in Pondicherry. I have heard that the portion of people who speak in French have survived over there. I do not know if there are any Portuguese language classes in Surat, but Dr. Sheth has been teaching French through friends of his in his training institute for quite some time. In fact, the book on Narendra Bhai was translated into French by a teacher of that particular institute. So French has survived, but Portuguese or Dutch have not. As languages, they are obsolete in India. So oversimplification should be avoided at the onset. It takes us to a very serious question as to why did India accept English when the British went and left, they quit India. Was it out of some sense of being crushed for so long a time that we accepted it? Had it been so, Persian would be flourishing in India, or Urdu would be flourishing in India, because that was the language of the conquerors that came before the British. But that is not the case. That language is also not, neither Persian nor Urdu is flourishing. Both languages are slowly declining. There are certain Persian departments, but they are the vestigial organs of those particular universities which were once grand places of learning in the old age or even in the post-colonial era. But no longer they enjoy the same status that they used to enjoy once. So neither it is out of some guilt or inferiority complex, neither is it out of merely some sort of a colonial past that we have accepted English in our lives. We have accepted it because it is the language in which the intelligentsia of the world communicates today. And not only the intelligentsia of the world, majority of commerce is also done in that language. Majority of international diplomacy is also done in that language. Air traffic control functions around the globe in English. The internet content is usually available in English. Some 90% of content on internet is in English. And out of the science and technology articles written, journals published, and expert opinions published thereupon, 96% roughly are being published in English. That is the reason why we have been retaining it. The past is the genesis from where our journey or our romance with English began. I would go one step further and say that it is out of a sense of belonging that we have adopted English. It is a very surprising statement to make. To be honest, I am also surprised that I made such a statement. But I would like to clarify why I made it. Dr. Apit Bhai has done his research and a very extensive work on translation of Vedas. Now, what is very interesting is that when India was conquered by the Turks, the Arabs, the Afghans, and the Mongols, and then the Mughals, a lot of devastation took over. Our universities were burnt, our books were burnt, scholars were slaughtered simply for being scholars, and our heritage was largely lost. It was so thinly spread across the continent that it has lost cohesion. There was no cohesion in the Indian knowledge system. When the British came, it was the British who started gathering things from various parts of India and compiling them. They began with a sense of superiority complex. They began with a sense when Lord Macaulay said that all Indian literature can be occupied on a shelf in a library in England. They began with a sense of superiority complex, but then slowly and steadily, Indian heritage, Indian literature, Indian philosophy, Indian religion grew on them. And a balance was established in which a mutual respect flourished. Indians had some respect about English, and the British had a newfound respect about Indian literature, philosophy, religion, sciences, etc. And their superiority complex gave way to their inquisitive nature, their sense of learning. And it helped not only the British to form an empire, but it helped world in general. New technologies sprung up where none existed. The blast furnace that ushered in the era of industrial revolution was first of all conceived in Bihar. The plastic surgery that we talk about, the British learned from the surgeons in South India. A number of science and technology initiatives that the British encountered over here, the concept of zero and decimal point and gravity and what not, which they had first learned from the Arabs, because the Arabs had transcribed the knowledge of India into Arabic, and from the Arabic sources it had gone to Europe. But now for the first time they were in direct contact with the Indian civilization. Though as rulers, they used to rule India, but still as rulers, there was a newfound respect for the subject race that they had conquered. And that respect was so profound and so widespread that it encompassed each and every field of human endeavor. To say the least, when the British were fighting the most determined enemy they had ever fought, in which they had to conquer a Japanese island where, say, a 500 strong troop had been stationed, they had to kill 495, and then the last five would kill themselves in harakiri, and it is only then that the English could conquer that particular, the British or the Americans could conquer that particular island during the Second World War. It was not the Scottish Royal Infantry or the Highlanders or the Irish regiments that the generals asked for. The generals asked for the Gorkhas, the Jats, the Sikhs, the Rajputs, the Marathas. That was the newfound respect for the new land that they had conquered just 190 years ago. There was a mutual respect between the British and the Indians. And that particular respect that we have formulated over years for a language and a people that gave us back our heritage. They have written books. Vildura has written Case of India. He has argued about us. He has argued about the loss that we faced. The place that we had in human wisdom, in the shining of light, of philosophy, enlightenment. And that particular mutual warmth has also crept into Indian psyche as and when we respect English as a not only a lingua franca, but also as a lingua pura. It might not be lingua pura for the world, but for us, they have rededicated their own energies into giving us back our heritage. It was impossible for us to compile everything had there not been the British era, and there would have been the continuation of the Mughal era. A lot would have been lost, which was not lost thanks to English. So that is one of the main reasons I see in the past why we have been such an affiliating people, so affectionately in love with English. That language has done something for us. Now, English is also a very fortunate language. When we say that this is the cause of love, that is not the cause why the Ambanis or the Adanis indulge into English. They indulge into English because it is having commercial importance, because it is an international language, because it's a language of commerce. It is the reason that they indulge into this language. And why is it an international language? And why does India need to, or rather is blessed and fortunate enough to have already had its lineage with English? That also has to be understood. I think we misunderstand the position of English as an international language in a way to have reason up with the British Empire. That is not the case. Surprisingly, the first and the foremost international document of diplomacy to have been also drafted in English is the Treaty of Versailles. At the end of the First World War, Treaty of Versailles, which defines or which limits the Germans from making certain armaments or using certain technology, that particular treaty, which finally Adolf Hitler could tear it off and throw it away, that was the first document of international diplomacy ever to be also, not only, but also written in English apart from French. Otherwise, French till 1914 to 19 was the language, or rather before 1919 was the language of international diplomacy. Even today, each and every document that is written in the United States, so correction, the United Nations, is in two languages, French and English. So intense competition is raging even today between the two international languages, whether French is the primary international language or whether English is the primary international language. Fortunately for us, English has won and English is prevailing. Its victory is also prevailing. And for all foreseeable future, English seems to be prevailing. Now again, we are in very dangerous waters. When I say it seems to be prevailing, had 1,000 years ago a scholar in Constantinople or Rome been told that Latin would cease to be a language of any importance in 1,000 years. Currently, Latin is not a language of supreme importance. Rarely does anybody learn Latin except for academic pursuits. Nobody learns it for practical purposes. Had anybody told 1,000 years ago to somebody in Constantinople, in the capital of the Eastern Roman Empire, or in west, in the city of Rome, they would have laughed. They would have laughed in Londonium, they would have laughed in Paris, they would have laughed in not only Rome and Constantinople, but across in Venice, across the civilized centers of Europe, they would have laughed that this gentleman has got absolutely no knowledge that we Romans are here to rule and that Latin is going to be the prime language for all times to come. Had somebody told Panini that Sanskrit will lose its luster in a 2,000-year span, or had somebody told Chanakya, might be he would have understood because he would have seen the Greek horses drinking water in this Sindhu, but a teacher who taught Chanakya, if he would have been told that Sanskrit will lose its luster in just a span of 2,000 years and your Takshashila and Nalanda will become useless ruins, he would have laughed. In the same way, from these august dais, I would not like to make any predictions that 1,000 years from today, English will still remain the lingua pura of the world or lingua franca of the world. It is not for me to make such a prediction, but the future course of action can be understood from what is there in the past. Why did English become an international language? They won in the Battle of Agincourt, they burned the Spanish Armada, they retained their freedom, they colonized the world. It was not they who discovered the American continents, neither south nor north, but they were the ones who colonized them. They were not the ones who discovered a route to India, but they were the most successful colonizers when they came to India. And they won the Battle of Plassey, they could even survive the 1857 revolt. and they established the British Raj. In parts of China, they prevailed. In parts of, they could colonize entire southern continent, the known continent of Australia and New Zealand, a newly discovered place, they could colonize it entirely. In 1/4 part of the world, the British could establish an empire. My friend has a long stay in Fiji, where also again the British were a dominant force for so many years. From Malta to Fiji and from Ireland to New Zealand, there is a huge span of land that has been dominated by English-speaking people. And therefore, second language of the most numerous peoples of the world has been English. English has not been a native language of the maximum number of people around the globe. Because with 1/5 of humanity being Indian and the other 1/5 of humanity being Chinese, naturally, English has no chance. Because population is one of our biggest successful industries, enduring industries. So, we will not allow English to prevail in that sense. But as a second language, English is most popular across the globe. And that is because it was dominating a number of places around the globe. But it was not the British who gave this stature and this status to English. Most surprisingly, it is the Americans. And it is quite comic to note. Have you ever thought that why did American English come into being? American English came into being because the Americans hated English. I began with a very funny paradox on India. I would like to return the favor to English native speakers of English, the Americans and the British. And I would like to quote somebody none less than General Patton when he spoke during the Second World War to an audience in Britain. He said that, "I come from the United States of America and you are all Britishers. We are the same people, separated by the same language. We are separated by the same language, and that is English, because you speak British English and we speak American English." The reason why American English flourished is rooted in American identity. The Americans wanted a separate identity, and it is not the British who forced the writers of the Versailles Treaty to write that treaty in English. It was the Americans. Because the Americans were a major portion of that war. They had joined late. They had not, usually Americans joined the party late. Either in the First World War, or in the Second World War, or in war against terror. At times they would be funding Bin Laden also. And after that, when everybody else leaves or exits the stage, they would enter and again pick up that fight. So they are usually the last to arrive and the ones to claim maximum benefit. So the Americans demanded that the Treaty of Versailles should also be written in English. Not the British. The British were happy that the treaty is written in French, because they wanted an average Britisher not to understand what is written in the treaty. It was the Americans who wanted an average American to understand what Treaty of Versailles is all about. And that is the beginning of English as a lingua franca. The lingua franca begins from the Treaty of Versailles. Before that, all international diplomacy, air traffic control was non-existent. Internet was yet to come about. There was no major trade and commerce being done only in English. Everybody knew French. Everybody who was somebody knew French. And the language of diplomacy was per se French. by the arrival of the Americans, the situation changed. The groundwork had been laid by the British. They had dominated the globe. They had taught English to multitudes. Perforce, English had become the second language of the world, whatever their native language may be. But the real final blow to every other language was hit by the Americans. And therefore, British English slowly started to lose shine against the American English because it became the new hallmark of international intelligentsia. It was in American English that most of the political discourses then began around the globe. And America became a superpower. For nearly 40 years, it was a very toughly contested event whether English or Russian will become the next lingua franca. But fortunately for Indians, and also unfortunately for Indians, because again, I began with paradoxes and I would like to continue with paradoxes, that it was paradoxical for us that the Russians lost. We lost a very powerful friend when the USSR broke down. That helped us a lot in 1971, that helped us a lot in retaining our position on the international stage, but we would have been seriously damaged if Russian would have evolved as a lingua pura or a lingua franca. Fortunately for us, we had our feet firmly laid on grounds where English was a prevalent language, a respected language, and it was the Americans who won the Cold War and not the Russians. And the Indian knowledge of English, Indian acquaintance of English, was a big tool in our jump towards fortune. Then came the Chinese. Fortunately for India, the Chinese have surrounded themselves in a bubble. They are not allowing easy access to internet to outsiders about Chinese websites. Neither are they allowing the Chinese people an access, a free access to international internet. They are living in a bubble of their own. So fortunately, Mandarin cannot dominate. It is the Chinese who are responsible. China may flourish. Mandarin won't. Same is the story for the Arabs. It is highly improbable given the distaste of technology that the Arabs have that the Arabs will come out as victors against the Americans. Highly improbable. And therefore, it is highly improbable that Arabic will be the next lingua franca. For all foreseeable future, English is to remain the next international language for a long, long, long time to come. But again, I am in the domain of speculations. And as it was impossible 1,000 years ago to speculate whether Latin will remain the main language, it is impossible for me here today to predict with complete certainty that English will retain its position as of now. I conclude by saying that whatever may be the dominant language of the world, Indians have a knack for languages. Whatever language will emerge, we will learn it. If not master it, then we will be power users of the language. We will be able to use it properly. And we will be flourishing on account of our learning that language and power using it for our own purposes. That is the Indian way of doing things. I think in my own limited way, I have tried to confuse you all on basis of the confusions that I already had in my mind. And feel free to get confused and add to that confusion in your own personal way. Thank you very much for listening.
Thank you very much, sir, for your interesting speech. So, programs don't just become successful on their own. There are a lot of people behind them. Let me begin by thanking our guests. A big thank you to the owner of this Monarch Studio, Mr. Amit Zorba. I would also like to put on record the help and support of Mr. Pawan.